This win streak in school history. Kentucky, on the other hand, on a slow start. They're looking to right the ship and pull another upset of the Gamecocks the way they did 2 years ago here in Lexington. Mike Patrick, Ed Cunningham, Janine Edwards, our entire ESPN2 crew. Great to have you with us. Steve Spurrier has his team on a roll, Ed. Undefeated, sixth in the country, and they are very good on both sides of the football.
I thought last year Steve Spurrier did his finest job as a head coach. Whenever you lose a guy like Marcus Lattimore, the running back that they lost early in the season last year, and you have to get rid of your quarterback and bring a guy in Connor Shaw that nobody knew anything about, that was a masterful job. Now they get Lattimore back and he is healthy. That knee brace that he wore for the first three games was taken off against Missouri. Looks like Lattimore is 100%.
Kentucky won the toss. They deferred to the second half. So South Carolina will receive the opening kickoff. Joe Mansoor, a junior, 6'2", 184, back to kick to Bruce Ellington. Had a 50-yarder a week ago. From Commonwealth Stadium in Lexington, we're underway. Nice kickoff through the end zone. South Carolina will start from its own 25-yard line. Connor Shaw, 11-1, as South Carolina's starting quarterback. He is a true dual threat performer. He has completed his last 20 passes. That's only four short of the SEC all-time record. Missed his first, hit the next 20.
But he's a guy who also, like Kentucky's quarterback, Mack Smith, dealing with a little bit of a shoulder injury. Got kneed in the back against Vanderbilt. Was able to finish that game, but sat out against East Carolina and couldn't finish the UAB game last week against Missouri. Was fine. It's not an injury that affects anything other than if he gets hit again, there's a little bone floating around behind his shoulder that can become bothersome.
They give it on the sweep to Ace Sanders. And Sanders taken down after a minimal gain. Let's take a look at tonight's impact players, brought to you by Chick-fil-A.
For South Carolina, if you look at their entire team, the only place that you can say might be a weakness is that offensive line. TJ Johnson, a senior in the middle. There's a bunch of personnel moves. He'll be the guy who has to bring them together. And Devin Taylor doesn't get a lot of recognition because of Jadeveon Clowney, but he is a good space player, can rush the passer, and is 6'8" tall, disrupts the pass lane quite often.
False start, 53 offense, 5-yard penalty, remains second down.
That's Corey Robinson, the new starting left tackle, as they moved Mike Petulis to right tackle. But he hurt his shoulder this week in practice, so Brandon Shell is starting over there. They're still trying to find the best five to put out there, Ed.
And Steve Spurrier has been very vocal about this offensive line. You watch them on film, they're not bad. They're just kind of coming along as an offensive line. Remember, they lost three starters off of last year, so still figuring it out a bit.
Connor Shaw, quick set, throws incomplete through the hands of Ellington, who's coming back from his flanker spot. That offensive line looks a lot better when you've got a guy like Connor Shaw behind him and a guy that can run like Lattimore behind him.
Connor Shaw brings a whole different element in the run game, but now you get to third and long. Connor Shaw, the strength of his game is not the long throw. So don't be surprised if Spurrier gives him something underneath here, maybe another screen or something to try to break it. That's the one part of Shaw's game that he needs to work on, is some of the deep throws.
First series of the game, the crowd's already on its feet. Connor Shaw in the gun on third and long. Four-man rush. They put some pressure on it, but they can't get there. Shaw runs away from trouble and runs into a big shot after he got the first down. Middle linebacker Avery Williamson and Martavius Nellums hit him. I'm sorry, it is short of the first down.
Pretty good hit at the end of this play. Shaw has wonderful speed once he gets into the open field. And number 40, Avery Williamson, very lucky. I think because he hit him with his chest, wasn't called for the targeting there because the quarterback was going down. But Shaw, who had an 80-yard run, called back against Missouri for an illegal block. When he puts it away, he can really scoop.
Tyler Hall to punt. What a great defensive stand to start the ball game. And this is DeMarco Robinson. There is a flag down as Robinson takes it all the way back to the 20-yard line. A 49-yard return, but there is a marker down.
Yeah, they're going to get Demaryius Ransom for a linebacker with an illegal block in the back. And just a, I'm not so sure if Ransifer doesn't make that block if it's not just dead right there. So it's almost, you can't blame him for trying.
During the return, illegal block in the back, number 49 of the receiving team, 10-yard penalty, first down.
What a huge play that would have been for the Wildcats. Yeah, it's clearly got him.
Push right there on Devontae Holloman, a spur. That is not number 21, Marcus Lattimore, the running back. Of course, a lot of colleges with over 100 players have double numbers, and as long as they aren't on teams together, they're fine.
Kentucky's quarterback Max Smith missed last week with an injury to his throwing shoulder. His health is a primary concern. When he is okay, he has an outstanding release and a very accurate short pass. Fakes the quick run and throws the pass to the man who just brought the punt back, DeMarco Robinson. And we'll check in for the first time with Janine Edwards.
Well, Mike, Maxwell Swift's health has been the subject of the hottest topic all week here. The coaches did tell us that they're estimating his health to be at about 80% for this game. I'll finish after the play, guys.
In trouble, makes the smart decision, throws it away, and there's a flag. And Smith is down, holding his leg. Myron Jarrido planted him.
And the problem is, as Janine was saying, the big story being the health of Maxwell Smith. Last week against Florida, they actually went with Morgan Newton, a senior who'd been switched to wide receiver. This is a grounding call, which is the correct call. And boy, that's just too bad. Just one of those awkward plants. There's nothing dirty about what Jarrido did right there. Just the way Maxwell Smith jumped back and landed very awkwardly with the weight of Jarrido on that. And here comes the true freshman, Jalen Whitlow.
Whitlow, last week, they didn't want to throw him in against the Florida Gators in Gainesville because he still knows very little of the offense. And they felt it was just, with no reps during the week, it would have been impossible for him to run any of the offense. So Morgan Newton actually took one for the club because he wasn't ready to play quarterback. Like you said, he changed positions. But they put him in there, and he did everything he could to run the offense. But he did not play well, and we are going to see, apparently, we will see Whitlow. We'll check out the quarterback change when we come back to Commonwealth Stadium here in Lexington. He walked off the field after being tended to when he was hit on that last pass play. He's obviously in pain. And Jalen Whitlow will come on to play quarterback.
And I think the only thing, as we take another look at the hit on Smith, completely clean. Again, don't think about the NFL. There is no rule below the waist for quarterbacks in college football. But I've got to think this is going to be a quarterback draw or some type of running back draw for Whitlow.
Takes off and grabbed and spun down before he had a chance to clear the line of scrimmage by Aldrick Foreman, who has a sack and a half coming into this game, and Kentucky will send on the punting team. The front four of the South Carolina Gamecocks can put tremendous pressure on a passer with no blitzes. Just a front four, they can drop seven, they can be a nightmare.
Three NFL players at least up on that front, if not more in the depth than some developing players. They may be as good up front as LSU.
Landon Foster to punt to Ace Sanders. Sanders on the run, swallowed up, lost a yard, trying to get the yardage on that return. Martavius Nellums, the corner, chased him down after a 37-yard punt.
Ball Primetime is presented by Miller Lite, because when friends come together, it's not just a good time, it's Miller time. And in part by the Volkswagen Jetta. That's the power of German engineering.
Well, we didn't have time to stop on the way into the stadium this afternoon, but it sure smelled good on the way in, didn't it, Ed?
This is one of the most beautiful spots, the rolling hills with the grass where everyone parks.
It's gorgeous.
It is absolutely spectacular.
Working on Max Smith, trying to retape that ankle where he was injured. South Carolina, great field position. They start at their own 44. Connor Shaw in the gun with Lattimore beside him. Connor Shaw in the keeper. This kid can really run. Goes down at the 41-yard line. Here's Wendy Nix.
Thank you very much. We stay in the SEC. Take you to Athens. Tennessee trailing by a touchdown there in Georgia territory when Garrison Smith forces the fumble. Tyler Bray loses the football and John Jenkins recovers. It's 51-44 Georgia. Less than 2 minutes to play.
A lot of big numbers today, huh?
Is that the Alamo Bowl from last year? Baylor and Washington.
Shaw, good protection. Now he takes off. Crossed the 40, got out of bounds at the 38. Steve Spurrier says that's what makes him an exceptional quarterback, the fact that he can do it with his legs. And Spurrier would know about exceptional quarterbacking as both a player and a coach.
I think this is the best runner he may have had as a coach.
Agreed.
The vertical pass is still not something they have down. Connor Shaw, he's getting better. He's getting more accurate in the short and medium. But he tends to hold the ball sometimes when Spurrier calls his vertical routes. And, boy, if they can add that, this becomes a really good offense.
Lattimore just wearing a sleeve on that reconstructed knee. He took off the brace a week ago, said it feels better. It was pretty restrictive. Williamson, the middle linebacker, was in on the tackle. Here's a kid that has 41 tackles through the first four ball games. Really a standout on this Kentucky defense that's been hurt on the ground. They're giving up 200 yards a game on the ground.
And I would think if they had the vertical pass game, possibly you call a post or something here to try to get one, but this feels like a run play. Kentucky's a lot of bodies around the line of scrimmage.
Two tight ends on the field. Shaw, nice fake. And if you're a defender, there's no reason to jump up in the air. Taylor Windham, one of their top prospects, goes straight up on the fake, and there goes Connor Shaw.
And here's where I think Steve Spurrier, in the last 18 months, has shown just what a bright coach he is. I think a lot of times you get wrapped up in the old ball coach thing. This guy's calling an offense now completely based on a quarterback that he didn't even think was going to play last year. They have to let Steven Garcia, they throw him off the team, multiple rules violations. And middle of the season, they make the change, and they've developed an entire offense around him.
Fake the flanker sweep, the throw for the end zone, wide open and drop. Shaw, a perfect throw right in the hands of D.L. Moore on a post, and he dropped it. Well, maybe it's a wide receiver and not a quarterback problem.
Well, either way, it's the thing that Steve Spurrier brings up every time anyone asks him about his offense. He says, yeah, we run it pretty good. We got a quarterback who can run. We just can't hit the long pass. And maybe 6 inches shorter, that's a perfect throw, but that's a pretty nice throw. You've got to be able to make that play.
Lattimore goes in motion. Shaw looked his way, now takes off, and they've got him. Escapes and slides. No signal from the officials. Now one does say he was down. They've almost had Connor Shaw in the backfield twice, but that speed, he's able to run away that time. Tristan Johnson thought he had him, and Shaw just sprinted out of trouble.
And you can't say enough when you have a quarterback that's this tough and powerful how that raises the level of the play around him. But I think, again, you're in that third. The problem with playing defense against South Carolina now, you have no idea what they're going to do here. Quarterback runs in play. The throw game, the intermediate throw game, with this type of guy, third and six is tough to defend.
Blitz. Shaw throws underneath Ellington. Inside the 10 to the 6, first and goal. Martavius Nellums made the saving tackle.
And this offensive line that has been beat up a little bit in recent weeks, a blitz comes, and even though they don't quite pick up Avery Williamson, Williamson was on a delayed stunt, a delayed blitz, and that allows Ellington, who's very good in space, a former running back, to get to the crossing route.
Lattimore. And he's not running the way he used to run, at least to my eye. I think he's still a little bit tentative, but he's close.
The one thing he has done, and I agree, it's hard to tell. And there goes Smith going off. It looked like they were going to try to get him back in the game. But.
Lattimore. That's more like it as Lattimore lowers his shoulder, stopped inches shy.
And this will be another Lattimore run. He became the school's touchdown leader against Missouri. And a lot of it is because how good he is between the tackles near the goal line.
Quarterback keeper to the goal line, no signal. It will be fourth down.
And I think Steve Spurrier will do the exact same thing. Either a quarterback, that looked like they got enough push for a touchdown there. I'm not sure. Tough to review, though, because you can't see the ball from that far off the field. But I think this is the same thing. Quarterback sneak.
And with a defense like they have, why not? Force it, even if you don't make it, force them to go 99.
And as Coach Spurrier likes to say, takes two field goals and you're still short of 7 points on a touchdown.
Yeah, he doesn't like field goals.
No.
Timeout. South Carolina, that is their first charge timeout. This will be a 30-second
timeout. Unless you're on the other end of his barbs, is one of the most entertaining people I've ever had the pleasure to be around. He is just so funny. He will tell you the truth. He will tell you what he believes, whether you like it or not. And he said a couple of times, you know, we kicked 5 field goals in 2 games. I lost both of them. I don't think I'm doing that anymore.
And a guy that, again, I think he goes up to the NFL, and like a lot of head coaches from college that went to the NFL, didn't have the success a lot of people expected. Changed his entire offense as he needed to throughout his time here at South Carolina. And last year, you know, we were talking to Rick Minner, the defensive coordinator for Kentucky. They played South Carolina the week that Stephen Garcia was benched at, the week after Stephen Garcia was benched against Auburn and then thrown off the team. He said, we had no idea what to expect with Connor Shaw, and all of a sudden this offense comes in that's a quarterback run-based offense, and we couldn't be ready for it. We didn't know what type of offense they were going to run.
He's doing it now with the running game and defense. Who would have thunk it? Fourth and inches. Extra blockers to the left of the formation now. Everybody shifts. Connor Shaw, and he did not make it. What a stand by Kentucky. It looked like number 51, Tristan Johnson, was able to get under the pile.
This is one of the hardest things as a center, when a guy like Johnson at 6'1 jumps forward like that, because the center has to go straight forward. TJ Johnson cannot sidestep a nose guard who's going to submarine that low. That was technique by the center, that he was trying to get on an edge. They were trying to get Shaw to step back a step and then find the A gap between the guard and the center to the right, and that was just not great technique at the point of attack.
Whitlow gonna have to start out of his own end zone. He gives it to Raymond Sanders, and Spurrier hoping for that first touchdown, didn't get it.
It's a very difficult block. Going in from the 1 yard line, coming out from the 1 yard line for a center is a very difficult deal when there's a nose guard who's gonna dive through your legs like that.
Whitlow rolling left, throwing short, complete for maybe a yard to Gene McCaskill. He's taken down. Janine has an update on the starting quarterback. Janine?
Well, Mike, I was watching Maxwell Swift as they were evaluating his ankle, and they did try to get him back in the game. They taped it heavily, and as soon as he stepped down off of the training table, he went like that. I mean, he couldn't even put any weight on his leg, and he told the trainers that it was hurting just too much, so they untaped him, and they took him to the locker room, and they're going to do x-rays.
Here's Whitlow on the run. Thank you, Janine. This kid's got some quickness. He's out to the 15 for a first down. And if you're a Kentucky fan, you've already had some great stuff to cheer about.
And Whitlow is a young man. There was two true freshmen recruited into this class. The top recruit was Patrick Toles, who they're going to redshirt. But Whitlow comes in from Alabama, and he was the starting quarterback on the 6A state championship Alabama high school football team. That's pretty, it's about as high level of high school football you can play in the entire country. So this is a guy who's won. And yes, he is playing for the first time when a game matters. Got some time last week at the end against Florida. Let's see how he holds up.
There's a lot of heat on Joker Phillips, they say, even though he's only in his third year, but he has recruited some talent on this football team. Jadeveon Clowney, number 7, comes from his right defensive end spot. This guy is a man-child.
Unblocked. So if you're Randy Sanders, the offensive coordinator, what do you do now? You bring him down inside, you boot right around side of him. So look for a potential bootleg here to that side with a fake going over to the right.
But he can probably outrun anybody on your team.
That's a problem.
Pressure. Kept the play alive, but it's incomplete. You can see the quickness that Whitlow has, but he was being chased down by Myron Gerardo, and Gerardo is 316 pounds.
Whitlow looks like he's very calm. Did not panic right there. He knew he had the athleticism to get away from Gerardo. And one of the things the veterans around here talk about this young man is how cool he is in the pocket and just how calm he is as a competitor. You're starting to see it a bit.
Third and long. Draw play. Straight up the middle comes Sanders. And Sanders has another Kentucky first down. This is a team that has not had much success, particularly defensively, but after that goal line stand, the offense is really pumped.
Watch Larry Warford, the right guard, takes out two South Carolina defenders. Just washes Chaz Sutton right down inside. Wonderful block by the senior right guard.
And that pass skips to the wide receiver, Robinson.
Well, it looks like they ruled that complete. That ball looked like it clearly hopped. Unless we're playing stick ball. Yeah, they're going to have to.
That hit the ground.
Well, the result of the play was just about what an incomplete pass was, so.
Whitlow to the shotgun. George is the running back with him, and he'll go out on the pattern. Whitlow with a lot of time. Throws complete to Robinson. This is the 19th ranked defense in the entire country.
You mentioned the time. Watch the chip on the defensive end by Jonathan George. Just gets a nice bang there on Devin Taylor, and they stoned this great pass rush. This offensive line for Kentucky, one of the strong suits.
They chipped on the other side, too, and got a piece of Clowney. That's the only way they're going to keep these two big guys out of the backfield.
Pretty good plan here so far for Kentucky with a young quarterback.
Adjusting on the fly. George on the draw. George to the 26-yard line. Heck of a block by Warford. The tackle made downfield by Bryson Williams, the strong safety.
And George is a guy who started the season third string, and because Koshik Williams is out with a hip and Josh Clemens is out for the season with a knee injury, he's taken control of this running back position, and Coach Joker Phillips says he's earned the right to be our starter, even though Raymond Sanders, who's been suspended for breaking a team rule earlier in the year, is back.
Last four plays have gone for 60 yards. Here's another 7 or 8. George running hard. Bryson Williams made the stop. I think South Carolina is shell-shocked right now.
Well, I think South Carolina probably put in that tape against Florida last week, and they saw Kentucky playing with essentially a receiver at quarterback, And now they've got a freshman who seems to have command. This offensive line's playing great. I think this is a surprise.
Second and a yard. The fullback, DJ Warren, will get a carry. His first of the entire season. And he gets the first down.
And this is South Carolina's bread and butter. You get into the red zone, and this defense is one of the best in the country. You lose the vertical stretch of the passing game. They are so athletic and fast in their linebacker and defensive back level. They can come up and make tackles because the stretch is gone.
Draw play. Good, tough running by Sanders. You'll get about five. And there's a flag as well. That could have been a face mask. Keep in mind, though, South Carolina's defense the other 80 yards has been really good.
So what you're saying is overall South Carolina's defense good.
Yes. Yes.
Personal foul, face mask, number 24 defense. Half the distance to the goal, automatic first down.
If any team ever needed to have everything go their way, it's the Kentucky Wildcats. And right now, it is going their way.
And I'll tell you, DJ Swearinger, who was suspended against Missouri for an illegal hit against UAB, lucky because he came targeting into the back of Sanders as he was going down.
Sanders, the deep man, gets the carry, has to make one man miss, and then is swallowed up, couldn't even get back to the line of scrimmage. JT Surratt, who's missed the last three ball games, got it.
And I think you've got to be careful if you're Randy Sanders. Once you're inside the seven or six, there are just too many bodies in white jerseys to run the ball effectively between the tackles. You have a quarterback who can move a little bit. He's a freshman getting his first real action. I'd want him out of the pocket or some type of option potential.
This will be the 14th play of the drive as they try to go from one goal line to the other. They'll run it inside again for very little Raymond Sanders. Now you've got to be careful down here with a quarterback who has virtually no college playing experience against a ball-hawking defense. Don't do something silly.
I understand, but I think if you're playing for a field goal here, you're just not going to be able to win this ball.
Oh, I agree.
Yeah, so I think you're going to have to throw it here, get this young man out on the edge. He looks pretty good in the pocket, but I think it's going to be tough to keep South Carolina out of the backfield if this is a straight drop back.
Well, they'll be coming now on third and five. He looks for the end zone on the slant. Knocked down. Good defense by Jimmy Legree. They tried to get it to LaRod King, but Legree jumped the route, and now they'll have to go for the field goal.
I like the call. It's an accurate throw, but Jimmy Legree cannot play this any better. Watch this. Jumps it right away. Did you see he didn't waste any foot movement? Right as he stood in the right spot, he had inside leverage on the receiver where he stood up. He didn't need to move his feet until he read slant. He jumped it perfectly.
Craig McIntosh will try from 22 yards out. He got it. Fleet did a nice job on the hold, getting down a poor snap, and Kentucky has the lead.
You're watching Tailgate Week, fired up by Kingsford Charcoal.
Welcome back to ESPN2 College Football Primetime, presented by Miller Lite. And surprise, Kentucky leading number 6 South Carolina 3-0.
And you know what I would do if I were Joker Phillips?
Onside kick?
Why not? Had such a tough game last week against Florida. Max Smith couldn't play. Again, he's out. You've got a freshman at quarterback. You've got some momentum. Just do one of those drag kicks about 10 yards and see if you can't get it.
Ellington waits at his goal line just in case. Seven yards deep, he'll take a knee. Let's take a look at tonight's impact players. Brought to you by Chick-fil-A, Ed.
For South Carolina, we'll go with another center, Matt Smith. We're already seeing the offensive line playing well. This guy leading the front against one of the better fronts in all of college football. And Avery Williamson, we've already seen his productivity at middle linebacker. When you play an offense that runs the quarterback as much as South Carolina does, that position is very difficult because you have to read where the ball is, especially on that zone read. So Williamson starting to get that experience where he can find the ball.
See if South Carolina tries to pound it a little bit, because Kentucky is 97th in the country against the run. And they have given up 219, 183, 163, and 200 yards in their four games. They do, and Lattimore doesn't have a chance. Miles Simpson, the weak side linebacker, the first man to hit him. These are not good numbers. Even 182 against Kent State, which is not a team you would expect would be pushing around an SEC team.
And Kentucky lost two guys at outside linebacker, Winston Guy and Danny Trevathan, two NFL guys off of last year's team, and frankly, they just haven't been able to replace them yet.
Shaw with plenty of time, throws underneath. That's going to be complete, but complete to the 29-yard line, all only for 4 yards. The crowd and the Kentucky defense want an incompletion. They contend the ball hit the ground.
Let's take a quick look.
Thought Lattimore caught it.
Well, not surprised. No, I think they should stop it and review it. I'm not so sure he caught that. And this is a big review, too, because third and 10 is a whole lot different than third and six.
And that's what they're going to do.
That is the end of the first quarter.
And remember, all plays are reviewed. I think if they look at that from a couple different places, they may see that ball did, in fact, move as he was hitting the ground or touch the ground and assist with the catch.
Well, now they're really going to have some time to look at it. That's the end of the quarter. We'll be back to Kentucky after this.
Football in High Definition is presented by Vizio.
It's a shocker so far in Lexington, Kentucky, with the Wildcats leading number 6 South Carolina 3-0. The Gamecocks have it at their own 29, third and 6. The last play, apparently they did not review it in depth, and Connor Shaw in trouble. This time he can't get away. Three guys put the pressure on Alvin Dupree from his linebacker spot, forced Shaw to move, and then he got help.
Dupree, a guy who plays with his hand on the ground at defensive end and Summit linebacker, times it up perfectly. Lattimore goes into cut blocking, but that was a wonderful job by Dupree. He got his arms down and was able to fend off the low block by Lattimore. Lattimore used nice technique, just better technique by Dupree. And this is a guy they're hoping comes along and they can kind of move him around to multiple positions on rushdowns. Well, that's a pretty good start.
Hull to punt to Robinson. Signals fair catch and retreats to his 41-yard line. A punt of 37, no return, and they are pumped at Commonwealth Stadium. The 1-3 Wildcats have the lead. In 2010, a ranked South Carolina team came into Lexington. They were number 10. Near the end of the first half, Steven Garcia hit Marcus Lattimore, 47 yards. Gamecocks had a 28-10 halftime lead. Everybody figured it was over, except for the Wildcats. Their defense didn't allow another point, and Mark Hartline hit touchdown passes of 5, 38, and 24, the last one with only 1:15 to go for a stunning 31-28 victory, the only time a Kentucky team has ever beaten Steve Spurrier. Is there magic in the air tonight? Already you're on your backup quarterback, Jalen Whitlow, and he's under pressure, and down he goes. These guys are relentless. That time it was Reginald Bowens, the middle linebacker.
And here's what a true freshman quarterback needs to learn about not just college football, but the SEC. This is delayed blitz, a little bit of a cross blitz with the linebackers. If there's a guy who has a free run, you can't outrun him. So just throw that ball away. He's had a little bit of luck bouncing out, but when a guy's got a free run, you just have to throw it away.
Second and 23. Whitlow, maybe a yard. Let's check in with Janine.
Well, Mike, exactly what Ed was just talking about, those Carolina linebackers. When they came off the field after their last defensive series, they had three coaches in their faces, including defensive coordinator Lorenzo Ward, saying linebackers have got to get more active. And he said, guys, we told you how well they were able to run the ball versus Florida. We have got to stop the run, and we have got to block this quarterback's vision.
Well, they blocked it the last time. Clowney held off on the double team. One-hand catch over the middle by King, who just reached out and plucked it like it was a baseball, taken down by Devontae Holloman. And here comes the punting unit.
One thing that Lorenzo Ward worked on and may unveil this week is allowing his defensive ends, Clowney and Devin Taylor, to walk around instead of putting their hand on the ground on third and long. And part of that is because Kentucky has such a quick throw game. He wants a 6'6 Clowney and a 6'8 Devin Taylor in the face of the quarterback of the Wildcats.
Foster to kick to Ace Sanders, one of the best in the country. He's averaging 16-3 on punt returns, high and short.
Oh, but that's what his coach told him, right? Joker Phillips said kicked it about 35 yards and out of bounds.
And he did just that. You've got to keep it away from anybody named Ace.
And college football primetime brought to you by the all-new Honda Accord. It starts with you and 5-hour energy, hours and hours of energy.
Tailgate week here in Lexington, and next up, the Monster Mile at Dover, where points leader Jimmy Johnson is right at home on one of his favorite tracks. South Carolina will start from the 36. Shaw blitzed, runs out of trouble. Tremendous speed down the sideline to about the 47-yard line. Maybe South Carolina just has a first quarter thing going. They didn't score last week against Missouri, then got 21 in the second quarter.
Well, this is what Connor Shaw gives you, because that was called up perfectly by Rick Mentor. And I saw a defensive coach on Kentucky sideline throw his hands in the air as Khalid Henderson, a true freshman that they expect to be a very good player, came absolutely free on a blitz. And Connor Shaw dipped him and ran right around him. You dial it up and, sorry, didn't work.
Yep. That's why coaches always have gray hair. Shaw out in the flat. Lattimore, nice cut back inside across the 50. Down to the Kentucky 47, and we check in with Wendy Nix.
Mike, thank you. We've got a primetime pulse over on ESPN. It's Florida State and South Florida. Just a 3-point game in the third quarter. And on ESPNU, number 3 LSU, also leading by 4 over Towson, 7-3.
Wendy, thanks very much. 3-point game here as well. Second and about 4. Shaw underneath the Lattimore. And Lattimore has enough for a first down. They'll mark it at the 32-yard line.
It's so dangerous when you have a running back who, when he falls forward, he gets a yard and a half. So that was a vertical pass route. You could see Connor Shaw was reading down the field. Kentucky had both vertical routes and the underneath route covered. You give it to Lattimore, and he just happens to fall forward and pick up the first down. Again, you defend it, but just so many things South Carolina does well right now.
Shaw, good play fake again. Chased again. Throws on the run. This time has a wide open man inside the 10, inside the 5. Nice throw to Anderson, the backup tight end, 37 yards. He got behind the secondary.
Wonderful
Shaw,
job.
That's a tough throw.
Wonderful job by Shaw. That's Anderson there on the end of the line of scrimmage. You could see very good job by Anderson, because he saw the linebacker reading run and he bent his angle away from him. That's a heads-up play by a sophomore, and give Connor Shaw credit for keeping his eyes downfield.
What a tough throw going to your left. He couldn't really square up. Shows the arm strength he has to get it down there. Lattimore.
Well, they are talking about Khalid Henderson, number 22 for Kentucky, thinking he's going to be a big-time guy. That time, he ran through the first guy. Lattimore couldn't make him miss. He missed the sack. You're going to have some of that with a guy who plays this hard. He missed that sack against Connor Shaw, but that time, cutting through the gap between the left guard and the center, gave Lattimore no time.
Second and goal. Shaw on the rollout. Throws for the end zone. Touchdowns, Ace Sanders. The little guy got outside for his third touchdown grab of the year, and Connor Shaw's 4th. I think he's a much better passer than people give him credit for.
He's got plenty of arm. He was more of a running guy in high school, got here kind of as a running dual threat quarterback. But he's worked awfully hard. His feet kind of fail him occasionally in the passing game, but he's worked awfully hard to improve.
Adam Yates for the point after. And the undefeated Gamecocks of South Carolina go on top 7-3. Connor Shaw's touchdown pass to A. Sanders did the trick. Johnson is the points leader, and he'll take that record to Dover. Hot on his heels, Brad Keselowski, Tony Stewart, Dale Jr. also in the chase for the cup. The NASCAR Sprint Cup Series at Dover, presented by GoDaddy.com tomorrow, 1 Eastern on ESPN. Raymond Sanders is deep. And so is DeMarcus Sweat, who has tremendous speed. There goes Sweat to the outside. Sweat up to the 34-yard line.
Well, in the last couple of years, if you were in this position and you had Alshon Jeffrey, you'd run the straight fade, throw it up. But now that you have a shorter guy with A. Sanders, watch him fake to the inside and the deadly move to the outside. This is actually good technique by Martavius Nellums. He probably should have got his hands on him there when he did that stutter step. I think you got to close that air, but just two different ways to throw the same pass. If you have a 6'6 guy like Alshon Jeffrey, you throw it up. If you have a guy with A. Sanders quickness, you let him fake the inside and bust it out.
The other Sanders, Raymond, gets a carry, picks up maybe one, stopped by Devontae Holloman, the linebacker. That front seven for South Carolina, those guys are pretty darn good. Whitlow in the gun. The freshman came on to replace Maxwell Smith, who injured an ankle right at the start of the ball game. They were so excited to have him back after he aggravated an old shoulder injury, but he gets hurt right away. Whitlow somehow got that pass in there. Augusti was right with him. There's a marker down.
Believe that's going to be pass interference.
Pass interference, number 3 defense. That penalty is declined. The result of the play is a first down.
And Augusti getting his first time since the beginning of last year. He had a foot injury that had him out the entire season.
What a throw by Whitlock.
Yeah, but Augusti was just a touch early. Yeah.
Yes, he was. Another chance to check in with Wendy Nix. Wendy?
Mike, thank you. It's a Taco Bell studio update. Oklahoma State playing host to Texas, and they were heard from quickly. Second play of the game, Joseph Randall takes off, and he is gone. 69 yards. It was 7-0, but the Longhorns have since tied it up, 7-all in the first quarter.
Oklahoma State still doesn't mess around on offense, do they?
No.
Whitlock from midfield. Here comes another blitz. And Whitlock grabbed around the helmet. That's going to be 15 yards. DeMario Jeffrey burst through and got him, but he got him by the top of the helmet.
Personal foul, face mask, number 33 defense. 15 yards from the previous spot. First down.
I believe he has the top of the helmet of Whitlow and not the face mask. You can grab the helmet as long as you don't take a hit at the helmet. There's no part of the face mask that's grabbed there. It's the top of the helmet. I can see it's a player safety rule, but I'm not so sure this flag should get thrown.
Well, he did come down with the right hand in a downward thrust, so you can call him for hitting to the helmet. and then he appeared to grab the opening at the just at the top of your vision.
Yeah, you can grab the helmet. You can grab the back of the helmet. You can tackle by grabbing part of the helmet. You just can't because that face mask makes the head turn so violently. But the call was the face mask. Again, I understand why the call was made. I'm just not so sure that that was a face mask. It looked to me like Jeffrey just had the top of the helmet.
South Carolina showing another blitz, and Kentucky picked it up. They're changing the call. Shaq Wilson, number 54, ready to come. He's ready again. The toss to Sanders, and Sanders breaking tackles. Still on his feet, down to the 12. Holy cow, Holloman finally made the stop, but it's a gain of 17 for Raymond Sanders.
When you play a defensive front like this, you need to get great edge blocking, and right here, Kevin Mitchell gets right on the hip. It doesn't look like much, but Devin Taylor was there and had position, but Mitchell rode him right out in a good cut by Sanders.
Nice block by Ronnie Shields, too. Got a piece of two different guys.
Nice job by Mitchell getting his left hand on Devin Taylor's hip and really displaced him out of the hole.
Whitlow throwing on a run, incomplete. Intended for Robinson.
Nice job by Sanders keeping his feet going, the hand down. How many times when you go out to practice do you see the running backs? Good job, ball security there.
Almost lost it, didn't
he? Sure did. That's a moment where even though your heart rate is already elevated, it jumps a couple of beats. But good job getting that hand down.
Two wide receivers to the near side. Whitlow, quarterback keeper. Inside the 10, spins, gets to the 8. They need to reach the 2 for another first down. Augusti, who they hope to get 15, maybe 20 plays in his return tonight, was in on that tackle.
And now this is the offense that Randy Sanders told us, if Whitlow had to go for extended time, that they would do a lot more quarterback runs. Of course, Smith with the bad shoulder, you don't want him to get hit too much, but he's more of a pocket thrower. This young man, I think you need to move him out of the pocket here. Give him a run pass option.
Keep in mind, as a backup and a freshman, he gets very few reps. Whitlow with a chance to take off. Good fake. Whitlow, touchdown. Jalen Whitlow, the first touchdown of his career. And he did the same thing to Shaq Wilson that Connor Shaw did to the Kentucky defense. He got him up in the air and ran right by him. The Wildcats have regained the lead against number 6, South Carolina. Sunday NFL Countdown presented by IBM comes your way at 10 a.m. on Sunday. Chris Berman and the gang give you all the latest news and updates from stadiums right up until kickoff. Then on ESPN2 at 11, Robert Flores, Matthew Berry, and Tim Hasselbeck. All the information you need to get your lineup sets for fantasy football now. Well, they usually reserve this kind of enthusiasm for basketball season, which is right around the corner, of course. But here at Commonwealth Stadium tonight, they are really enjoying this one.
You know what I would try right here?
The onside kick again?
Why not?
Comes the return for Ellington. I know your thought process, but your suggestions are falling on dead ears.
Whitlow looks anything but a true freshman, making his first significant playing time against the elite defense in the SEC. Remember, as we wait for the flag.
Personal foul, face mask, number 32 on the kicking team, 15-yard penalty, first down.
Big mistake on special teams for Kentucky, an area they said they had to make big plays.
Well, that's clearly a face mask, and we got it confirmed. We have Dave Kataya, who's the former Big East head of officials back in Bristol, Connecticut. You can grab the helmet so long as you don't grab an opening. So going back to that face mask penalty on DeMario Jeffrey. Probably shouldn't have been called.
Shaw sitting in the pocket now under pressure, and Shaw goes down at the 31. This is a Kentucky defense that gives up 400 yards a game. Not tonight. Tristan Johnson, 51, is having a huge ball game for Kentucky.
And Johnson does a stunt with number 99, Dante Rump. Rump comes to the inside. Johnson comes around the outside. And it was that submarine on the goal line, remember, on fourth and goal that Johnson stopped earlier in the ballgame.
Second and a mile. Shaw throws underneath to Bird. Bird gets a couple. And again, the middle of that defense, Rump 99 and Johnson 51.
And this is, again, part of the game that Steve Spurrier still wants his offense to come along, which is the long throw. Connor Shaw can do it. Sometimes he holds on to it. Let's see if he trusts him with essentially what becomes a seven-step long drop. And I think Kentucky with three down may bring some pressure.
Right now, this defense is playing out of its mind. Can they keep it up? Shaw buying time and throws it out of bounds.
Great job by Rick Minter that time. He showed pressure with the three down. South Carolina left in a bunch of white shirts to block. Only three guys went out, and there was eight to cover them. There was nowhere to go for Shaw. Minter going back and forth with Steve Spurrier, one of the best play callers in the history of the game. Chalk one up for Coach Minter and his defensive staff.
Yeah, this is not Rick Minter's first rodeo. Robinson is deep for Tyler Hall's punt.
And as a flag comes down, it'll help me clean up. Dave Kataya.
False start. 33. Offense. 5-yard penalty remains.
Dave Kataya, who helps us out back in Bristol, comes from us from the Pac-10, not the Big East. But glad to have him.
You know, he said your interpretation that you could grab any part of the helmet as long as there's not an opening. If there's not an opening, how do you grab the helmet?
Well, the plastic part. You can't put your finger in.
How big are your hands?
No. You can put your hand on the helmet. You just can't put your finger in the ear hole or on the side where the face mask goes.
And they went after it and blocked it. It'll be Kentucky ball at the 35. Kentucky said they had to have a big play on special teams. Darren Blaylock blocked the punt. Holy cow. That was their version, Ed, of an onside kick. You've got to make something happen.
And this is a rule, a safety rule that they put in, that you cannot fly over the wedge. And the reason I think that they didn't call it was Blaylock went to the side. If he had gone between those guys in the wedge, that would have been a 15-yard penalty. But because he went outside the wedge, it's a new rule this year, they didn't call it. And I think that's the correct no call.
Yeah, I think you're right. He went over the outside shoulder, because if he goes over the top, and it is a safety issue, that would have been a penalty and would have negated the punt block.
Watch as it goes to the outside instead of between the guys. And I think this is why they allow Blaylock to leave his feet. If he goes inside between the wedge, that is still a very...
That's a great call, Ed. You're right. If he goes inside, it would be a penalty. Kentucky trying to take advantage. Whitlow looks to the sideline for the call from Randy Sanders. Give it off to George, who had a big first quarter. Fighting for extra yards.
Man, there is a real battle going on at right tackle. Kevin Mitchell playing against Devin Taylor. That time, Taylor did everything he could to hold the edge, and Mitchell doing a fine job sticking with one of the better defensive ends in the conference. I'm impressed with this Kentucky offensive line against this front.
Taylor could have gone to the NFL last year as a mid-round draft pick. Decided to come back for a senior season. Pressure coming here. Whitlow throwing underneath. Incomplete. Good defense by South Carolina. Middle linebacker Reginald Bowens saw the screen, got right in the middle of it. It'll be third and eight. Well, you got it. If you're Kentucky, you have to take advantage of that block kick.
Yeah, I think you have at least two routes to one side. You don't want to overload this freshman. You got two receivers to the left. Run one to a post and maybe a double post behind it or a fade. I think you have one by the sticks and one towards the end zone. Just let him read high low.
Four-man rush. Throws near side, tipped and caught. Caught just outside the 10. Tipped by Jimmy Legree and caught by Darryl Collins. Are you kidding?
And Kentucky just dodged a bullet because the freshman did not see Legree. He thought Legree had dropped off into coverage, and he thought it was going to be an easy throw to Collins. But they get lucky because Legree bats that ball up, and it's perfect for Collins to run under.
Collins, the red-shirt freshman, did the toe dance at the sidelines. Would have been 85 yards the other way, wouldn't it?
Yes.
But another first down for the Wildcats just outside the 10. The handoff to Sanders. Raymond Sanders, touchdown. Ronnie Shields, the tight end, gave him a block to spring him. And Kentucky is taking it to South Carolina. Point after is good. A 34-yard drive and a minute 42 after the block punt. How about this? 1-3 is beating number 6. In two nights, finish off your football weekend on ESPN. It starts with Monday Night Countdown, served by Applebee's, 6:30 Eastern. Then at 8:30, Jake Cutler and the Bears go into Dallas to meet Tony Romo and the Cowboys. It's all on Monday Night Football.
You mentioned after the punt block that Joker Phillips told his team and told us, we have to have some big plays. And
yes.
Teams, we have to have some breaks go our way.
Yes.
Let's not forget that tipped pass by Legree.
Oh, absolutely.
Because if he gets a little more air on his jump, he probably picks it off and has a chance to take it the other way. And instead, it goes to Collins for the first down. And they dodge a little bullet because the true freshman didn't see Legree there hanging out. He didn't quite know the coverage on that one.
South Carolina obviously is a better football team and they have more talent. But Steve Spurrier said it best. Yeah, we're probably better on paper. If we don't play better, we're not going to win. Let's go to the studio.
Coming up on the Outback Steakhouse Halftime Report, offense everywhere on this shootout Saturday, much of it coming from Geno Smith. 95 points scored between the Hedges and Towson, by the way, currently leading LSU. I'm joined by Todd McShay and Robert Smith coming up at the half.
Wendy, Geno Smith was 45 of 51 for 656 yards and 8 touchdowns. If he's not on top of your Heisman list at the end of September, you shouldn't be keeping a list. Guy's been remarkable. Connor Shaw, quarterback keeper, out to the 29.
Awfully conservative call with a minute 52 left. Two timeouts. Let's watch this clock melt away. Very cognizant of how this clock starts to run down if you're South Carolina. It's an awfully conservative start.
Shaw again goes underneath.
And now Kentucky, I don't think on third down you use a timeout. Maybe you do. But right in here, Kentucky needs to start thinking about their three timeouts and clock management.
And that's exactly what they do.
Now, there's a couple of theories here. If you use this timeout here and they get the first down, a lot of people think, well, it's wasted. I go the other way. I think you go ahead and take it, and let's think of the positive what if. If we get the stop, look how much time we're going to save.
Sure, I think it's the only way you can look at it. And how many games did we watch, and we watch games all day that we come to the stadium, where coaches just butchered, clock manning. It's unbelievable to me how it happens week after week that people just let time run off the clock they so desperately need.
It's real simple. To gain yards and score points, you have to run plays. So you want to maximize the number of plays you can run in any scenario. And so it's about getting there, running the play. Sometimes you don't have to rush, but you better have some urgency. Right now, South Carolina, I think, is playing a little bit into Kentucky's hands with that draw. And then Connor Shaw throws one in front of the sticks. Kentucky uses a timeout. I think it's the right time to use it, but let's see if they pick up the first.
Well, Steve Spurrier has two timeouts in his pocket here. And in college football, with the clock stopping temporarily to move the chains, first downs are a huge advantage. Give you those extra seconds. The Kentucky defenders getting the crowd to cheer them on.
Watch for Ace Sanders here. He's at the top of your screen. Some type of maybe wide receiver screen to Ace Sanders.
Third down for South Carolina. Connor Shaw moving the pocket. Connor Shaw dives, and they're going to mark him down short.
That was Connor Shaw. That was just, he didn't know where the line was. He started going down too early. This was a run right from the start. I was eyeballing Sanders. He ran off and was blocking right away. Let's watch that knee go down. Well, that's just a mental error. And he got too good of a spot here. I think they should stop this and check the spot. I think this ball is a yard short of first down, not 6 inches. And I think the official should stop and look at this spot.
Yeah, his knee went down actually a couple of yards shy. You could give him the 34, but even that would be generous.
And remember the last time, let's check where his knee goes down and where the ball is. Knee down. No, he's at least a yard, if not more.
Right.
Beyond towards not getting the. I think they need to review this. This is a big deal because I think with more than a yard, Spurrier may punt this. With 6 inches, I think he goes for it. But remember, don't run it in the middle because Tristan Johnson's going to submarine your center.
Would you really go for it in this situation?
No, I'd try to get
Kentucky
him to jump.
That much more momentum?
I would try to get him to jump, and then I'd punt it away. You've got a freshman quarterback. You've got a good defense. I think Joker Phillips probably takes a knee if you punt it away. And on this side of the field, but if you're going to do it, I think off tackle with Lattimore. Do not, because Kentucky's going to stuck a bunch of guys in the middle to submarine your offensive line.
If you're thinking second half, South Carolina is good enough, they could put up 28, 35 points and a half.
Don't be surprised if they just try to get them offsides here.
It would be a huge gamble to go for it on fourth, especially out of the shotgun, where you can't quarterback sneak back snap. Kentucky's got the football. Holy cow. Taylor Windham with the recovery. So everything went wrong for South Carolina. Well, the old ball coach, not happy.
T.J. Johnson, the center, has to move to his left. And they're setting up what looked like slide pass protection. And the ball just sailed on him. What, again, Joker Phillips said, we need some things to go our way. I'd say they're kind of going his way.
He's gotten him here in the first half, hasn't he? Now can they capitalize on this?
And they're trying to fix the timing on the clock. They were at 56 seconds, wanted to make it a full 1 minute.
That was T.J. Johnson, who you saw on the sideline, number 55. The Gamecocks gambled, and it blew up in their face, and now Kentucky has a first and goal just inside the 10.
And a tough spot to score, one of the best red zone defenses in the country. Your freshman quarterback has to know he has a timeout. You can run the ball. It doesn't have to be near the sideline. Just use that timeout if it's going to take more than 10 or 15 seconds to get the next playoff.
Whitlow, draw play. Nothing.
But if you're South Carolina's defense right now, you're probably shell-shocked.
Well, Kentucky is going to burn. I know they feel like they have a lot of time, but this is, they need to go faster. I know this is a true freshman playing his first game, but this is just getting a play in. Randy Sanders just needs to get a play in faster.
I think they're riding a very fine line here about pushing your freshman and getting the play in, but it's burning a lot of time.
Oh, boy.
And now,
boy, this is
even
just,
more.
Yeah, this is bad clock management. Now they're getting a timeout, man. And let's make sure we point out this is a true freshman. Randy Sanders had basically one day of practice with him this week.
Exactly.
With the one, so that's difficult.
Welcome back to the SEC on ESPN. Kentucky has just squandered more than 30 seconds.
36 seconds. They were trying to get the perfect play in by the defense that South Carolina was running. Then they couldn't get a play in. Remember, true freshman, but now you absolutely have to. Everything, I think, has to be towards the end zone or the sideline. Do not do something in the middle of the field.
Whitlow has Sanders with him. Blitz coming. Whitlow to the end zone. And out of bounds. Caught by LaRod King. But he was about a yard outside the boundary.
Now, I think it's going to take a while. I think you want to flood the end zone with three or four bodies and layer them as they're crossing each other and hope that someone comes clean. The problem is it takes a little while to get that open. King makes a catch on the ball, but the throw was out of bounds. That's something you'll have to work with. That ball has to stay in bounds. But now, watch for South Carolina potentially bringing one extra rusher here.
They've got to throw it in the end zone or to the sideline. And Whitlow is sacked, lost the ball. Still loose, Kentucky has it to the one. DeMarco Robinson, the clock is going to run, and they're not going to have a chance to get a play. It did not look like South Carolina ever had possession. Therefore, the clock would not stop when Kentucky got it back.
And you go back to those 36 seconds that they lost. I know it would have been fourth and goal inside the one, but I still think you'd have gone for seven. Well, no, I think you go for three and you're up 20-7
exactly.
Against the top 10 team in the country.
At the worst, you get a field goal out of this. It's Kentucky squanders a real opportunity to have. Here's Janine with Steve Spurrier.
Coach, you told us this week that if the ball bounces funny a few times, things can happen here in Kentucky. What's contributing to these things going their way?
Out-playing us, out-hustling, out-hitting us, and they've made a few plays. I mean, we couldn't even follow on that fumble. Luckily, the clock went out. We're not real smart tonight, and we're going to be in deep trouble if we don't get smarter and start playing.
Thanks, Coach.
Doesn't mince words, and he's right.
Well, and here is that last play. Great pressure up the middle by number 57, Aldrick Fordham, and that ball just continues to bounce around until it's finally picked up by DeMarco Robinson. But because they had to use that timeout when they couldn't get a play in, it runs out. Let's mark this. This may be a huge gap for Kentucky.
Wouldn't that have been a finish if DeMarco Robinson picks up the
ball and
gets a touchdown? What a first half. 17-7 Kentucky. Now we send you to Wendy Nix for the Outback Steakhouse halftime report.
Tailgate week, fired up by Kingsford Charcoal.
Welcome back to the SEC on ESPN. We're at Commonwealth Stadium in Kentucky, where the Wildcats lead the number 6 team in the country, undefeated South Carolina, 17-7. If you're a Kentucky fan, the game couldn't have started any worse. Max Smith, your starting quarterback, who missed last week because of an injury, healthy enough to play, gets hurt on the first series. Everybody goes, uh-oh, what's going to happen? What's going to happen is everything good you can imagine after that.
And for Jalen Whitlow, comes in as true freshman, looks pretty good at quarterback, but all of the breaks that they've gotten, some of them have been made by themselves, fourth and goal. The nose guard submarines, and South Carolina goes nowhere in the quarterback sneak, and then one of the many true freshmen that play for the Wildcats, Darren Blaylock, legally goes outside of the wedge protection. And then, of course, on the last play, Whitlow fumbles the ball, and one thing that went right for South Carolina was Victor Hampton finished the play. If Victor Hampton doesn't make that tackle, it's 24-7. So they need a few more guys like Victor Hampton finishing the play for South Carolina.
Kentucky will get the ball first to start the half. Two yards deep out of the end zone. Swept. Can't break it. Gets to the 12-yard line. Kentucky will start from there. Now for tonight's game track, brought to you by John Hancock. Smith left the game on the first series. He's on crutches now. Whitlow, the backup freshman quarterback with very few reps during the week, comes out, gets 84 yards and a touchdown. Lattimore's been held to 5 carries for 12 yards by a Kentucky defense that has risen up in this one.
That is Dakota Tyler, a backup safety, hurt on the kickoff return.
As they work on Tyler's right knee, we check in with Janine Edwards. Janine.
Well, guys, Joker Phillips and his entire coaching staff are just so pleased with the energy and the passion that this team is showing right now. And Joker told me two things that we need to concentrate on in this second half. He said, we're going to try and get our quarterback to be able to run a little bit more. We're going to turn him loose, and we need to improve our protections. We've got to keep him protected. And as they were running out onto the field, some of the older players were saying to the young guys like Whitlow, hey, just stay loose. Just keep having fun. Just keep playing football.
Well, Janine, you can only imagine how much fun they're having right now. Up 17-7. This is a team that lost to 25th ranked Louisville 32-14 in the opener, beat Kent State, then lost to Western Kentucky, and were shut out by Florida last week. So they were 1-3.
And you mentioned early on in the very first season, or very first series, excuse me, Maxwell Smith gets hit low by Byron Jaredo, and sprains that left ankle. They taped it. They tried to bring him back out. But as soon as he got off the table, Janine reported, he just almost crumpled, couldn't come in. And here comes the true freshman, Whitlow, who I think, other than that throw he got away with, where Legree was hanging out in an area he didn't expect him to be hanging out, but the tip went for the first down. He's played pretty well, and I think getting him running the ball is the right plan in the second half.
Coming into this game, he had only thrown the ball 6 times and rushed it twice this season. On the toss, Raymond Sanders will pick up about 3 yards.
One thing that it's just been a recurring theme every time Kentucky runs the ball, is how hard the guys with blue shirts are finishing their blocks. That time, all the way to the end of the play, Ronnie Shields, a tight end, was driving his man towards the sideline. This is great effort.
Four-man rush, Whitlow trying to get outside the pocket and throws that one away. Closest man to it was King.
And that time it's Randy Sanders calling a sprint out protection. And not bad so far. This is a guy who, again, they brought in a higher ranked recruit than Patrick Toles, whose father this week publicly said he was frustrated he wasn't going to play, but the plan has been for him to redshirt. So Whitlow becomes the second stringer after they moved Morgan Newton mostly to wide receiver, but then he had to play last week against Florida because Smith, they didn't know till late, couldn't go.
3rd and 7. Whitlow hangs in the pocket, throws to the sideline, first down, LaRon King. Consider what happens with a backup freshman quarterback. You only have so much time to practice during the week anyhow.
But as odd as this sounds, it helped that Smith is injured, because Smith only threw with that shoulder injury on Tuesday and Thursday. Whitlow got all first string reps on Wednesday. He looks pretty good.
For a yard on the delay to Sanders.
And last week it was the polar opposite. Up until the end of Thursday's practice, which is really the last hard day of work.
Right.
It's the last day that you do any full speed route running. Max Smith was going to be the quarterback. They're getting ready. They go on the road to play Florida, and the coaches said, Jalen Whitlow was just not prepared. It would not have been fair. And you mentioned Morgan Newton may have taken one for the team, but the senior came in, at least had a feel for the offense, but they just didn't want to put Whitlow out there. And I think, frankly, it was the right decision going down to the swamp and a freshman who barely practiced all day.
Whitlow, quarterback keeper, that's a run all the way. And Whitlow's up near the 35-yard line. Joker Phillips was asked about that, and he said, look, you try to treat these kids like you are their own. You know, they're your family. You can't just throw them in a situation where they have no chance to succeed, and he wasn't going to do it.
And here's a guy who's under a lot of pressure here about his job, and he made a decision that was better for a young man. You have to really respect that.
Absolutely. Third and four. Kentucky has all the momentum in this game. Almost everything has gone right for them. Whitlow underneath, tipped and incomplete. Good defense by Shaq Wilson, the outside linebacker. He was all over LaRod King to make sure they didn't complete that one. And there's Max Smith on crutches, which is never a good sign. Foster to kick to Sanders.
And that's Max Smith doing a nice job bringing over Whitlow. Smith has been in the system now for 2 years.
The sophomore coaching up the true freshman. Low snap, he got it. And got it away. Beautiful kick. Sanders all the way back to the 26th. Nothing doing. Sanders dump on Martavius Nellums, his second solid tackle on special teams. Only return of three after a 39-yard punt. Welcome back to ESPN2 College Football Primetime, presented by Miller Lite. South Carolina, third quarter, down 17-7 to the homestanding Kentucky Wildcats. South Carolina ball. Lattimore has been contained. Breaks this one for a few, dragging a tackler with him out near the 40-yard line for a first down. Martavius Nellums got a free ride for about 7 yards.
I think this is Steve Spurrier saying, I'm kind of tired of watching all the other stuff flounder. And this offensive line, I know they've been harangued a little bit by their head coach, but they are big and physical. This, let's not forget, this is still an elite program. These guys can block, and this is a great back.
Lattimore this time able to push the pile for only about a yard.
And then I think what you're going to see come off of this inside run is potentially some play action, but also some quarterback runs where you're going to start seeing some zone read. But I think that Steve Spurrier wants number 21 to spark the engine a little bit for South Carolina.
They shuffled the offensive line this week, partly because of an injury, partly because of coaches' decisions trying to get the best five guys out there. Haven't seen many holes tonight. Shaw rolling left, throws to Sanders. Sanders knocked out near the 45-yard line. They need to reach midfield for the first down. And it was Cody Quinn, another true freshman, who pushed him out of bounds. Last week at times, they had four true freshmen in the secondary.
And now on third and medium. And that last shotgun snap from T.J. Johnson was just a little high and a little hot. So I think Spurrier's a little afraid of that. Goes under center. I would not be surprised with a play-action pass here.
Lattimore is the eye back. Option, Shaw, first down and more. Connor Shaw with the speed to break it. Had an 80-yarder a week ago that was called back because of a penalty. He can do that. Gains 14 on this one.
Nice job by Connor Shaw. They're running an option. It's a speed option. There's no fullback. The fullback's going to go block if there's a pitch. But as he's running down the line, he feels the opening, puts one foot in the ground, and turns up. This guy's very explosive. When he turns and runs, he starts running away from people, and that was a good read on the option to turn it up early.
Had a 92-yarder against Vanderbilt. We've already seen he's got a very strong arm. and pretty accurate in this ball game as well. Shaw got him up in the air again. That is a cardinal mistake by a defensive lineman or a linebacker. You leave your feet, you're helpless.
Third time we've seen it tonight. Two have been first downs, one has been a touchdown. It is so hard to teach someone like Miles Simpson not to leave his feet when a guy goes to pump the ball. But the problem is what you have to teach the defender. He's probably throwing a long ball, so he's going to launch it at a higher angle. So you don't have much of a chance to tip it anyway. So if anything, stay with your feet underneath you. If anything, just raise your arms. But you have to stay locked into the midsection of the quarterback and not get shaken.
Shaw straight back on this one. Post deep down the middle. Touchdown. Perfect throw to Damier Bird. He came into this game averaging 30 yards a catch.
And this is, that's the exact play. That post with number three Bird and number one Sanders and their speed, that's the throw he wants over the top. With Alshon Jeffrey, they threw a lot of jump balls. Now with one and three, you're going to see a lot of posts and corner routes by these smaller receivers.
And it's the same one D.L. Moore dropped early in the game. The point after is good, 17-14. The undefeated Gamecocks close within three. A 73-yard drive that took only 2 minutes and 36 seconds.
The Volkswagen Passat, 2012 Motor Trend Car of the Year.
That's the acclaimed thoroughbred Senyata, tailgating the way racehorse champions do. She lives in a place that's better than my first couple of apartments. That's really nice.
And was actually watching the 2010 upset of USC here at Kentucky. 2010.
Sweat and Sanders are deep. Sweat. Got speed. Cuts it back out near the 25, and we check in with Janine Edwards. Janine.
Well, Mike, one thing that South Carolina defensive coordinator Lorenzo Ward wants his guys to focus on right now is just shifting and movement. Try to get Kentucky to throw it on a crossing route. And I heard three different South Carolina defensive players reminding one another, stay on your guy, stay on your assignment.
Well, that's the only way they're going to get back in this game, Janine. They're down by three, 9:27 to go, third quarter. Can Kentucky stay at this level?
And of course, Lorenzo Ward, who was the defensive coordinator last year, but Ellis Johnson was the head coach in charge of defense. And of course, Ellis Johnson leaves to go to Southern Mississippi. And Lorenzo Ward, who spent 7 years at Virginia Tech under what I think is the finest defense coordinator in the country, Bud Foster, doing a nice job.
Clowney this time, along with Taylor and Quarles. Big Kelsey Quarles at 286 inside, put on the pressure and bring down Whitlow.
Clowney uses his hands so well to push off the left tackle. Such a wonderful job on Darian Miller. He just used that quick swim move. He stabbed him with his hands, and then he broke him down and put that left arm over the top, and Miller couldn't hold on.
Third and 15, and here's where South Carolina really comes after you. They have a defense they call Rabbit, where they put in two more defensive ends, so they've got four ends in the pass rush. Whitlow hangs in the pocket, throws too high.
Clowney was offsides and got away with that. Big break for South Carolina here. It would have been third and 10, and Joker Phillips has every right to be upset. There's no doubt that Clowney was in the neutral zone. In my view from up here, was in the neutral zone. Watch the top of your screen right there. Yeah, you've got to call that. Plus, it starts to become unabated to the quarterback. At some point, you've got to blow it dead.
He's quick, but he's not that quick.
Yeah, he's trying to get a jump on the count. A lot of the defensive ends will do that. They'll listen to that count and start to zone in and get a hold of it.
Sanders is deep. That trying to kick the ball out of bounds was the game plan coming in. The last two have not been, but they've been nice high kicks. That's 38 yards. Connor Shaw has brought him back from 10 points down. Can he get the lead back? for heavily favored South Carolina.
High Definition is presented by Vizio.
Welcome back to beautiful Lexington, Kentucky on a crystal clear night, a perfect evening for football. You're trying to knock off the number six team in the country, and you're only 1-3. Things have to go your way, and they have to go your way all night long. Can it still keep going that way for Kentucky as South Carolina has good field position from its own 43? Connor Shaw, little half roll, throws to Sanders, and Ace gets about six.
And one of the things that South Carolina's running game has done to Kentucky is it has put their safeties at 10 yards from the line of scrimmage. And that's number 31, Mikey Benton. It looked to me like he was a little confused that he had some deep help, turned and ran late. But because they got Lattimore going, Steve Spurrier knew the post would be open because those safeties have to come down. Watch as the safeties have to come closer to the line of scrimmage with both the short pass game and Lattimore.
Lattimore, you got to hand it to the middle of that Kentucky defense. They have been stout all night.
And they're missing one of their best players, Mr. Cobble, who got an infection during camp, has not quite been healthy. They thought he would be available, but he's not.
And you're not being formal. That's his first name.
Mr. Cobble.
Third and a yard.
Feels like Lattimore time.
Doesn't it? The All-American, nice cut down to the 40.
He is so good at those little cuts between the tackles. It goes without saying, a guy who can run this well between the tackles has good vision. But watch this cut right here.
Oh.
He completely set up Ellington to at least get a piece of the linebacker because Ellington, the slot receiver, wasn't quite in position.
Over the middle, complete to the tight end, Justice Cunningham. You know, there are a lot of running backs that can make the last run that Lattimore did, except for the last cut.
Yeah, he's got that feeling just in space where people talk about vision. It's not about seeing the hole. Set up your blocks. Make the one cut that makes the linebacker think you're going right so then your guard can come in and hit him.
Lattimore lowers his shoulder on this one, has a first down at the 29. Still can't get him down. He's to the 28. There are games we have seen Marcus Lattimore simply third and fourth quarter just impose his will on the other team.
And once again, a lot of guys make moves, but they go laterally when they make the move. Lattimore has that ability to put one foot in the ground, shake his shoulders, and then gain yardage on his next step.
This drive and the last one have quieted this crowd, which was so energetic. Shaw being blitzed, runs away from trouble again. Nice cut and got out of bounds.
And that time, strike one up for Rick Menner, the defensive coordinator. I think that Steve Spurrier was expecting the safeties to come down on first and 10 on a running down, running down, you'd expect the way Lattimore's getting them interplay coverage with a deep safety and took away the two deep receivers to the left for Shaw. He had nowhere to go but to his right.
Second, call it 8. Clock running, approaching 5.5 minutes, third quarter. Shaw completes this one for a first down. Ellington makes the grab. And this is what really good teams do. They're down, everybody's against them, and they find a way to collect themselves and come back.
Nice throw by Shaw. But that's what Steve Spurrier has been talking about with this team now in his 8th year here at South Carolina. He feels like he's got a group of seniors and a group of leaders who know how, when things get tough, to focus in, fall back to your training, fall back to your techniques, listen to the adjustments we're making, and you're seeing a clinic in that right now.
Touchdown, South Carolina, Kenny Miles. First carry and he bursts off the left side. The senior showed you some speed there, didn't he? Kenny Miles' first score of the season put South Carolina on top. Connor Shaw has been very impressive tonight, running the ball and throwing it, a true double threat signal caller. Kenny Miles puts the favorite Gamecocks on top. Welcome back to the SEC on ESPN at the 4:56 mark of the third quarter here in Lexington, Kentucky. Heavily favored South Carolina has the lead, but it's been a struggle. 21-17 over a stout Kentucky bunch.
Feels like a key drive here for Kentucky.
Sure does.
All of the momentum when they didn't score there at the end of the half. They had the bad clock management. Then they had the fumble that looked like they may run it in, but the great tackle at the end there that let the clock run out. From Sanders, then forward, it's been all South Carolina.
Sanders and Sweater deep for Yates kickoff. He'd been sharing the duties with Ard, but has now taken over the full-time job, as well as the place-kicking duties. It's a beauty here. And Kentucky will start from the 25. Let's check in with Janine.
Well, my Kentucky quarterback Maxwell Smith obviously devastated that he's out of this game with an ankle sprain. But he told me that he is trying to contribute, which is obvious. He's been talking a lot to Randy Sanders, offensive coordinator, and also Jalen Whitlow. And he told me it's all happening really fast right now for Jalen. He said, I know the feeling. I've been there. I told him just stay calm. And he said he tried to help him with his vision as far as picking up the safety and where the blitzes are coming from.
Janine, a lot of this is learning on the fly. Whitlow running here, taken down short of the line of scrimmage, chased from behind by Clowney. And Clowney can run down something on the freeway.
And Whitlow, it's Max Smith has experience with being a true freshman and playing in this conference.
Yes,
because
he
just did it last year. So if there's anybody that could help him out, it's Smith.
Pressure coming again. The throw underneath to the tight end, Ronnie Shields. They'll mark him out of bounds at the 23. They have to reach the 30, or at the 28, they have to reach the 35 for first down.
And I think if you had Max Smith in there, quarterback, this would be something like maybe you run a deep out cut. But that, with a young quarterback, just be careful with a long holding the ball for a long time in the pocket. I'd be very nervous about a deep route here.
South Carolina shows blitz. Pressure on Whitlow, trying to run away from it. Whitlow with room, first down and more. 47-yard line, first down Kentucky, a gain of 19, and South Carolina thought they had him dead to rights.
And give Raymond Sanders a lot of credit. The running back lined up to the right, goes all the way across the formation, and picks up the blitz from the outside. And that's what Whitlow dumps underneath eventually. That was Devontae Holloman coming, but this guy's got just a little bit of ability with his legs, doesn't he?
He does that.
Now left guard flinched. Zach West. And you don't get two for flinching, you get five.
False start. 76 offense. 5-yard penalty remains, first down.
Excuse me, that's Eatman Nard in there instead of the 75 West. 76 is in there.
Ted. Only the third Kentucky flag tonight, the first on the offense. And they're very proud around here, telling me how smart that offensive line is. All of them with very difficult majors. They've acquitted themselves very well on the football field tonight. Sanders gets a couple, so it's going to be second and about 13.
That 5 yards is a big penalty. You're just starting to get it moving. Whitlow makes a nice play, and now you get kind of even yardage play, 1 yard.
Pressure coming. Whitlaw taken down at the 35-yard line. Devin Taylor with career sacks, now 16 and a half. He is fifth all time. Has 1.5 tonight, so give him 17 for his career.
Watch the swim move. Slap with the left and then right over the top. So hard. And guys who really know how to do this, it's the timing. As soon as the tackle, Kevin Mitchell, shoots his right hand, you slap it. That's just a feel and timing thing. And if you slap that hand on time and then get over the top with your inside hand, that's awfully tough to block.
You have to feel for Mitchell. He's playing on a gimpy ankle. Whitlaw under pressure again from behind, spun down at the 35-yard line, and it was Chaz Sutton. They've got some backups that can play on this line, too.
Chaz Sutton is a guy that they was challenged heavily by Lorenzo Ward and the defensive staff. They said, hey, we want you in this mix. You've got to bring up your play. Sutton is a guy that has a ton of ability, but they didn't feel like he was reaching his potential. And he's really picked up his game. I believe that's his fifth sack on the season.
Sanders back at the 25. Nice high floater. No fair catch this time, but he's dropped again. And Alvin Dupree, the linebacker, was there. He and Nelson have had a tremendous night on special teams. Next up, the Monster Mile at Dover. Points leader Jimmy Johnson right at home on one of his favorite tracks. He'll have to outrun Brad Keselowski, Tony Stewart, and Dale Jr. as we continue with the chase for the Cup. The NASCAR Sprint Cup Series at Dover, presented by GoDaddy.com, tomorrow 1 Eastern on ESPN. Denny Hamlin with the poll earlier today. Joker sees the momentum slipping away from his ball club here in the third quarter. Lattimore cut down. He thought he had that one. He thought he was going to go 80. Cartier Rice chopped him down.
And talk about when you have a knee injury for Cartier Rice coming in on Lattimore. This is the type of hit you want to see. Does he bounce up and come right back and make it? And that's ex-high school teammate on ex-high school teammate Cartier Rice with the Burns High School, the same high school as Lattimore. So thanks for that, teammate.
And so much of the recovery from any kind of a serious injury, especially a knee, is getting hit there again and finding out you can take it.
Please reset the game clock to 1 minute, 22 seconds, 1:22.
5-second adjustment on the game clock by this officiating crew.
And Lattimore was talking about that knee brace. And a lot of that is just mental because you feel it on your leg. And knee braces, they basically stop one injury, which is what you just saw. If a guy comes in and you have weight on that leg, it can stop that kind of lateral hit. But any kind of torque injury where your foot gets stuck, it's not going to stop that. So a lot of guys just say, if I've had an injury and I'm stable, get rid of it because it makes me think about it too much.
Now he just has the sleeve on it. Lattimore again. Kentucky doesn't budge this time.
And how many times do you see an injury where a guy who's usually carrying the ball gets rolled up when he's downfield blocking? And it was not a pretty sight as the bodies landed on Lattimore. And of course, carted off the field. And when you see a parent walking with the cart, you know that the injury is severe. Worked awfully hard during the offseason, starting to get into that feel of 100% of what he looked like last year before the injury.
And was having another brilliant season last year after over 1,000 yards as a freshman. Most people thought he was the best running back in the country. Lattimore first in rushing touchdowns, first in total touchdowns. He's really only played 2 years, and he's already ninth in all-time rushing and has 900-yard games to his credit.
And you feel like it's Lattimore here on third and short, but don't be surprised if Spurrier dials something up with a plate fake. Only one deep safety.
And it is Lattimore, and it is a first down. And a first down that will end the quarter here at Kentucky. South Carolina has taken the lead 21-17.
Ready to start the fourth quarter. South Carolina finally with the upper hand. Kotke hasn't had much to crow about tonight.
He's starting to warm up the pipes though a little bit.
I think so. First down from the 44 to Lattimore on the toss. A couple of nice cuts. Picks up three to the studio and Wendy Nix.
Mike, thank you. It's a primetime pulse just underway. Alabama and Ole Miss, that's on ESPN. LSU and Towson on ESPNU. It's been close, but finally the Tigers leading 24-9. And on ABC, a 10-point game. Wisconsin leading Nebraska. Mike?
Thanks, Wendy. 14:32 to go here. South Carolina has taken the lead. Gamecocks marching. They've reached their own 47. Lattimore running past and through people to the 30. Here's Janine.
Well, Mike and Ed, you touched on Marcus Lattimore overcoming the fear of getting hit again after tearing that ACL. And that is the one thing that head trainer Clint Haggard told me was the biggest thing he had to work with Lattimore on. And Haggard said he actually had to talk the coaches into letting Lattimore get hit in practice. And he and his coaching staff went out with big dummies on the field to simulate hits that Lattimore may have gotten. And he said, you have to live through a hit and know that you'll be okay to overcome that mental hurdle.
And Janine, Steve Spurrier said he knew how hard that Marcus Lattimore was working on his rehab, because Steve had knee replacement surgery and he was working on his rehab too.
Different goal involved with Coach Spurrier's knee surgery.
Yes.
Lattimore's.
Wanted to get that golf swing.
Yeah. There was a competitive bent to it, but it wasn't on the football field. Somebody needs to fix that flapping shoulder pad for Lattimore. Got to clean that up a little bit. Of course, not against the rules, but usually someone in the huddle grabs the shirt and pulls it back over for you.
This has just been a smash mouth drive by South Carolina.
And this is the type of drive this offensive line dearly needs. If you start looking at this thing going forward for South Carolina, Georgia at LSU at Florida. The only question mark for South Carolina has been up front. Looks like they're starting to get a little deep throw game going in this ball game, but this offensive line, if they can find a group and they can get Matulis healthy, have a couple of guys to rotate into that guard, that's going to be awfully helpful with the next three-game stretch after this one.
South Carolina is 3-for-3 on third down conversions in this half after struggling with 2 out of 7 in the first half. And now they're going to take a timeout here on a big third and one from the Kentucky 21-yard line. Get your NFL Sunday started off right. First at 10 a.m. Eastern, Sunday NFL Countdown. Chris Berman and the gang. All the latest news and updates from stadiums right up until kickoff. Then on ESPN 2 at 11, Robert Flores, Matthew Berry, Tim Hasselbeck will give you all the information you need for your fantasy.
Here's what I hope comes out of the fiasco that was the replacement referees and officials in the NFL. That we as commentators and fans start to realize at the SEC, Big Ten, Pac-12, the big conferences, and in the NFL, the best of the best are doing this job, and we should appreciate how often they get things right.
Yeah,
in a
right.
Sport that is incredibly difficult to officiate. I think that just proved it without a doubt what we saw throughout the last couple of weeks in the NFL. These guys do a superb job.
Yeah, it's been a long time since we said we could miss referees, huh?
Yeah. And I think the NFL got a valuable lesson in how important and valuable those NFL. I wonder how many things they gave up on during negotiations after what happened Monday night in Seattle.
Yeah, that did have some influence.
You think?
Third and a yard. Gilchrist is in as a blocking back. Kenny Miles is in as the tailback. And Miles gets to the 20-yard line, enough for first down.
One of the things when we were talking to Steve Spurrier about the difference between now and when he was at Florida is And he always had good defenses and a good runner usually at Florida. When he was at his best, they had awfully good defenders. But, you know, he looks around college football now and he sees all these schools running 80, 90, 100 offensive plays. Right. Well, that just means your defense has to go back out and defend 70, 80, 90 plays. And he feels like they're good enough on defense if they can limit the other team to 60, something around 60 plays per game. Kentucky right now at 52. But this is totally different than what you would expect. But Steve Spurrier says we want 50, 60, 65 plays a game on offense because we don't want to trot our defense out there. And we just want to get them rest because they can be dominant when they're rested.
Nine plays on this drive so far, all have been runs. Lattimore is back in the tailback. Kentucky's defense has to creep closer and closer to the line of scrimmage. Eventually, you're going to see some play action out of Connor Shaw. Dante Rump makes a stop here.
But if you look around college football with the spread and the hurry up and how many people at Oregon trying to run a ton of plays, and you look at what South Carolina has done, it's way down the list, 101st. And, of course, in our conference call, Steve Spurrier got a dig in on that team, the other team in our state, mentioning Clemson, saying they wonder why they can't play defense. Well, can't run that many plays on offense, play defense. So he was sure to get a dig in.
Shaw throws underneath, got his fullback Gilchrist, and Quay Gilchrist very close to a first down. Boy, nice decision by Connor Shaw. Saw the opening. He could have run it, but why not get it downfield?
I've said this, and people look at me like I'm crazy. When the toughest guy on the team is your quarterback, and he makes plays like this, it raises the level of everyone. I played with Dave Craig in the NFL, and Dave was not the best player by any stretch of the imagination, but he was mentally and physically the toughest guy on the field at all times.
Went to a lot of Pro Bowls. Quarterback keeper on third and inches.
No, they got that one right. Remember that fourth and goal early in the ball game when Tristan Johnson, the nose guard, submarine the center, TJ Johnson. That one they went almost outside of the guard to run that. I don't think they wanted to mess around with the middle of that defensive line.
I remember Dave Craig saying, I live in Seattle, so if a quarterback drops out, I'm in the Pro Bowl. Shaw looks to the sideline. Fullback is McLaurin. And there's Lattimore moving the pile inside the five near the three. Good block by Ronald Patrick.
See how patient he was? He had blockers, but there was no hole that opened. So all he did was just slow down, get in behind one of those blockers, and pick up the yardage because, you know, eventually they're going to start pushing the defense back.
Lattimore, 19 carries for 101 yards. Well, you know that offensive line's got to be pretty good. They got two guys up there named Patrick and Cunningham. Lattimore, nice cut. Touchdown, South Carolina.
That's elite. That's elite. That cut is just... It's so hard if you're a linebacker because... That close to the goal line, you have to chase. You have to come downhill on the first step of the running back. And a guy who can cut like that, it's just so hard to defend.
A bruising drive for South Carolina. 81 yards, 14 plays in 7 minutes and 12 seconds. 13 of the 14 plays were on the ground. They just decided to take it to Kentucky.
And watch Lattimore as he gets his heading to his right, one step off to his left, back to the other side of the formation. And Nellums does his very best. But because of that cut, it's an angle tackle, and the power of Lattimore goes in for a touchdown.
In 2 nights, you can finish off your football weekend right here on ESPN. It starts with Monday Night Countdown, served by Applebee's at 6:30 Eastern. Then at 8:30, it's the Bears and the Cowboys on Monday Night Football. South Carolina this half, three drives, 211 yards, three touchdowns. They are playing like a team that heard some bad news at the half.
I think they did from their head coach.
Exactly.
What was the week going to be like if they didn't turn things around?
Sweat takes a knee. We check in with Janine Edwards.
Well, guys, even before South Carolina scored this last touchdown, Kentucky's offensive line coach Mike Summers sat his O-line down and said, guys, you have been blocking your tails off all night. Now that it seems the momentum is shifting a little bit, you're going to start throwing in the towel. He said, not on my watch. The good thing, guys, is that South Carolina's drive took so long that the O-line for Kentucky did get a nice breather.
Janine, they have to play this last 9-17 the way they played in the first quarter. They need to make plays. Screen pass, Sanders. Well, what a night he's had. Sanders to the 49-yard line.
And he did a wonderful job setting up the block. This is a screen all the way of the left tackle, Darian Miller. Watch 77 come out right there, cuts behind that block. Gave just enough of a stutter step to get behind the block of big number 77.
And Miller's playing on a bad angle. Three of these guys up front are hurt. This pass intercepted right in the hands of Devontae Holloman. Huge mistake by Whitlow. He must have never seen him because he threw it right in his mitts.
The hardest thing for any quarterback to see at any level is that second level of linebackers. When they're looking beyond that, it's something that's a feel, experience, coaching, how different teams play it. You feel so bad for Kentucky. Remember Max Smith, the quarterback, got hurt earlier. And Jalen Smith comes in, and he just does not see the linebacker Holloman drop off.
Raymond Sanders is the player who is down. He was in on the tackle, but a huge defensive play by South Carolina has turned this thing around.
Football Primetime is presented by Miller Lite, because when friends come together, it's not just a good time, it's Miller time.
Lexington, Kentucky, this is part of downtown, pretty area. Beautiful rolling hills outside of downtown, all these sports farms. It is just magnificent.
Devontae Holloman joined himself in Lexington so far.
Yes, sir. Well, South Carolina is going to look at this considered an escape if they win. Draw maybe 5 yards.
And this is something a young quarterback makes a mistake. Here's Holloman here, and over the top of Holloman, Whitlow is trying to fit the ball into DeMarco Robinson, but you can't throw a dart, a low ball here. You have to know that there's going to be coverage from somebody in that part of the field. It's usually an outside linebacker, which is exactly what Holloman is. You can't try to fit that ball in low. If you're going to throw it, you have to get some air on it. At worst, if you do that, then the linebacker usually can get a handle and tip it, but not intercept it.
Out of the eye, second and 7. Play action by Shaw has been terrific tonight. This time, hitting the backfield, taking down at the 36-yard line. Alvin Dupree made 3 or 4 big plays tonight. And all Steve Spurrier can do on that one is shake his head.
And this is a nice job by Dupree. Lined up in a stand-up position, and Dupree realized that Justice Cunningham, the tight end, didn't release, so he came on a late blitz, and there's nobody there to block him inside.
Third and 14 right now. It would be an extremely long field goal if they tried that.
Yeah, I think you want to cut this in half so you can run Adam Yates out and get this thing to 2 touchdowns.
Shaw has hit 14 out of 17 throws tonight. This one is to Sanders. And Ace Sanders picks up a few to the 31. Still going to be a 48-yard field goal try.
This is right on the edge of Yates. His career long is 38 yards. And this is right on the edge. And I think what Steve Spurrier may be concerned about is a blocked field goal that's returned. I think because you're right on the edge of your kicker, and I think this is the right decision. The way your defense has played in the second half, If Yates drives the ball, it gets blocked. They get a big return. All of that momentum with 6:55 left to go. I think Spurrier goes for it here, and I think it's the right decision.
Because if you punt and put the ball in the end zone, you gain 12 yards.
And this is a big enough decision, I think, to burn one of your timeouts. Let's talk about what we like. But this is right on the edge of where Yates is comfortable. Right at that 31, 32, 33 is the outside of his range. And I just think at this point you're worried about a block.
ESPN College Football is available anytime, anywhere on your computer or mobile device via WatchESPN.com and the Watch ESPN app. Only 6:44 to go in the game. South Carolina has come from behind to take an 11-point advantage. Let me play devil's advocate. If you do go for the field goal and make it, you're up 14.
I think he feels with this defense and the way he's running the ball, I think he feels like even if Kentucky puts a drive together and scores, I think I can just hand it off to Lattimore and eat the rest of this game up. Now, don't be surprised. Remember that post route we saw earlier to Bird? Be surprised.
That was perfectly thrown.
Yeah, and you know, also to this trip side over here to the right of Connor Shaw, you can run that wide receiver screen, but then slip somebody behind it while he's blocking, try to get a cheap one over the top as well.
Four wide receivers set. Now make it five. Got Ace Sanders in the slot left. Shaw, quarterback draw. Slips two tackles. Connor Shaw still on his feet, but he's going to be short at the 24-yard line.
Man, that's an awfully conservative call for Steve Spurrier. I know he trusts his defense, and I know they're playing a Kentucky team that has struggled, but this is a quarterback draw from jump street. This is not a pass play. One, two, go. Great running by Shaw, but there was movement up front. I'm surprised that that was not some type of throw beyond the sticks or something where they tried to slip somebody by on a wide receiver screen. That's awfully tough to pick up almost 11 yards on a quarterback draw.
Kentucky needs two scores, and there's not a lot of time to get it. They'll lose a couple of yards there as Jason Whitlow harassed in the pocket. Six sacks for that forward wall of the Gamecocks.
And coming into this game, nobody expected Kentucky would be able to do what they did in 2010, but nobody expected it then either.
Clowney with a lot of pressure. Ball bounces in the air. Picked off. Intercepted by Gerald Dixon Jr. Christmas comes early. That ball popped straight up in the air and right in his lap.
Well, and this should be an illegal touching call because the ball was thrown right at the, I believe it hits the center, Matt Smith, as he's sliding to his right. But it doesn't matter. The result of the play, because they would have declined it, is the interception. But Whitlow panics a little bit here. Pardon me, that hits the guard, number 67, Larry Warford, at the right.
Hit him right between the numbers.
But Clowney, as Whitlow was backing up, you know, that's a young guy starting to see white jerseys. You hope your quarterback doesn't look at the rush, but against these guys, you cannot blame the young man. Just panicked a little bit there.
Eventually, Clowney is going to be playing on Sundays, and he's going to be playing for a long, long time.
At least one more year, he's got to be at South Carolina.
Lattimore. And you just felt the air go out of this building.
Well, and you can start seeing people head for the exits. But for Joker Phillips, who is under extreme pressure here at Kentucky, there are a ton of positives to come out. This game felt like it was going to be a whitewash.
Yeah.
And it was. I know they got some breaks, but defensively they have not played bad. Their offensive line, I think, for the most part, held up better than we expected them to.
My first question, Ed, would be, why is he under such pressure in only his third year? You cannot turn a program around in 3 years. You cannot do it. Not from where they were.
Well, they were having some success under Rich Brooks.
Some.
I think Rich Brooks may have spoiled the fan base a little bit.
Yep. Lattimore goes in 34-17, and South Carolina has dominated under Steve Spurrier in this second half. They made a statement here in these last four drives. Point after is good with 5:19 to go in the game, 35-17. The Gamecocks over the Wildcats. Welcome back, and South Carolina got a good one when they hired Steve Spurrier to replace Lou Holtz in 2004. 35-28 in his first 5 years. Then 2010, SEC Coach of the Year. 2011, a school record 11 wins. This year, it's going to be a 5-0 start, a number 6 ranking. Only 5 times in the history of this football program have they ever been ranked that high.
And a lot of people in the South always wondered, why can't South Carolina put together a winning program year in and year out? Tons of high school football talent, including this young man, Marcus Lattimore, in the state. And Spurrier has completely changed the entire mentality in this program, and they're starting to get top 15, top 10 recruiting classes every year.
There was a lot of talent in the state, but South Carolina was not getting them.
Clemson, all the rest of the SEC, it's a competitive state, that's for sure.
Kentucky trying to do something on special teams, and Sweat breaks a couple of tackles and is buried back at the 12-yard line. Let's take a look at our FaceTime profile, brought to you by Edward Jones. Won 200 games earlier this year, and he says, hey, whole lot of dudes, I'm quoting, have won 200 games. Not much to brag about. Yes, it is. 8th season at South Carolina. He's now up to 59 wins. Won the national championship at Florida, 7 SEC titles, 9-time Coach of the Year.
I think he's going to get one here. I think he's going to get it. You're starting to feel. Last year was just an amazing coaching job by this entire staff. When you saw how it was bandaged together on offense, granted they had a great defense. Melvin Ingram was just, and with Jadeveon Clowney and just lights out. But you're starting to see this program now has an identity.
Draw play to Deshaun Mobley, who's getting a chance to play a little bit. Let's go to Wendy Nix.
Mike, thank you. It's a Dr. Pepper 10 conference update. We check on LSU and Towson on ESPNU. Towson hung around. The Tigers are pulling away. Zach Mettenberger to Odell Beckham. That's going to make it a 31-9 ball game.
Pass incomplete here from Whitlow, out of bounds. I think the other thing that people forget about Steve Spurrier, he is one of the few coaches in any sport who was a brilliant player who went on to be an elite coach. He was a 2-time All-American, won the Heisman Trophy. When he left Florida, where he played, he owned every passing record there. He owned every passing record in the Southeastern Conference. If there was a record, it belonged to Steve Spurrier. He was absolutely magnificent. Most of those guys don't know how they did it. They just did it. Well, Steve Spurrier understood.
One of the things that helps you be a good coach is when you have guys like Jadeveon Clowney rushing the passer. Just absolutely knocks the offensive tackle down, Darian Miller in front of him. I think Miller may have caught up on the running back as he goes by, but man is number 7. I think Miller got caught up and maybe injured his ankle, but number 7 is a powerful, powerful man.
Miller came in hurt, but Clowney, something else. Low line drive. Out of bounds, just a terrible kick. Got a timeout, 3:51 to go in the ball game. South Carolina has taken over. The SEC on ESPN. We're at Commonwealth Stadium in Lexington, Kentucky. And here's how the last 5 Kentucky head coaches have fared. Nobody at 500 or better.
And you made the point earlier, how can you not give Joker Phillips 5 years? When you look at that history, which has not been great, Rich Brooks had success, but he was still under 500 as a coach.
And we'll check in with Janine Edwards.
Well, Mike, and Joker Phillips knows what it feels like to be unsuccessful here in Kentucky as a player as well. In 1982, he was on a team that went 0-10. He said the big difference then, though, was society as a whole. The fans didn't have a voice. There was no internet, chat rooms, Twitter, etc. Well, just yesterday, the university and Phillips had to deny rumors that were swirling on the internet that he had resigned. The university actually had to put out a statement saying that those rumors were absolutely false. Athletic director Mitch Barnhart declined to be interviewed by us or to give us a statement, but a spokesperson did say that the university is standing by that statement from yesterday, saying that those rumors that Phillips had resigned were false.
Well, Janine, everybody down here knows that basketball is king in Kentucky. Horse racing is either 1 or 1A along with basketball. And then comes Kentucky football. It's very difficult to have success when you have any stumbles and people aren't behind the program. And that's what seems to happen year after year, as this ball's thrown into the end zone, incomplete by the new quarterback, Dylan Thompson. But back to the point about how long do you give a new coach? My feeling has always been you've got to give a guy 5 years so that his first recruiting class will be done. They'll all be fifth-year seniors. That's the only way you can judge somebody.
And be realistic about what you can expect at Kentucky. This is not a heavy football state when it comes to the high school level. And they have to travel outside of state, into Ohio, down into Georgia, into Tennessee, where they're competing against every team in the SEC and a lot of other schools from the northeast and kind of upper Midwest that come down into south as well.
Adam Yates bangs home the field goal, and Kentucky drops behind by three scores with 2:27 left. South Carolina, it was iffy for a while, but they are up comfortably now at 38-27. And they'll start from the 25. Let's check in with Wendy.
Mike, thank you very much. We check in on the number one team in the country, Alabama, trailing just a point, though. 7-6 Ole Miss, but not for long. Christian Jones with the answer. He is going all the way. And when he gets there, Alabama leads 13-7 to start of the second quarter. Mike?
Wendy, thanks very much. Whitlow back on the field for Kentucky's offense, with 2:27 left in this one, and the crowd filing out of Commonwealth Stadium. I thought Whitlow really acquitted himself pretty well tonight. Made the one mistake on a pass he shouldn't have thrown. At least shouldn't have thrown it the way he threw it on a line, and Deshaun Mobley gets a carry.
One of the things that gained some momentum this offseason was Les Miles, backed by Steve Spurrier, saying we should only consider games played within division to decide who plays for the SEC championship. And I think it, if you look at this, look at Georgia, compare that to the two other favorites in the SEC East, Florida and South Carolina.
False start, 70 offense, 5-yard penalty. Remain second down.
I think now that the SEC is at 14 teams,
yes,
and they're only going to play 8 games in conference, meaning 2 from the other side of the conference, teams that get Alabama and LSU at a disadvantage, teams that don't have an advantage. So I think there's actually some traction there and something that should be discussed. It is a bit unfair when you have teams that are playing teams from across the other division that are just better than the ones you're playing.
You must have a semblance of a balanced schedule. And if I have to play Alabama and LSU and you don't, that is not balanced.
And the only conference that is split in divisions that plays 9 games is the Pac-12. Because of the revenue issues, schools want to control more games than just 3. They want that 4th game to control for revenue, but it does, I think, set up a little bit of inequality when it comes time to deciding who the division champ is. I mean, South Carolina plays Georgia at LSU, then at Florida. So the two other best teams in the East and LSU, the second best team in the West.
Ball's loose, and it looked like Mobley got hurt, but he bounces back up. Had his knee buckle under him.
Boy, that looked awfully funny there at the end of that play, didn't it? As Whitlow jumps right there. Boy, he's very lucky he didn't sprain that left ankle.
Actually, that was Whitlow and not Mobley.
He's very lucky he didn't roll that ankle. Knee looked fine. Ankle looked like it rolled a bit.
Clock running. Draw play, Mobley. Taken down by Akeem Augusta, who's getting some good work in coming back off of an injury. Well, Kentucky gave its fans a thrill in the first half, didn't they?
They sure did. And I think have a lot of positive things. And you can see Whitlow is limping. I think he did sprain that ankle. Now, the tough part for them, if that thing swells and he starts to have a problem, as they host Mississippi State, remember Maxwell Smith hurt his ankle in the first game. So unfortunately for them, they may have two gimpy quarterbacks next week.
The final score here in South Carolina, in Kentucky, is South Carolina winning it 38-17. For Ed Cunningham, Janine Edwards, and our entire hard-working crew, we thank you for watching tonight. Now we'll send you to Wendy Nix and our college football scoreboard from Lexington. Good night, everybody.